everyone, and welcome to the Game Room. On this episode of SwitchGuide, we're going to be talking about Final Fantasy Adventure, which was offered as part of the Collection of Mana on Nintendo Switch.
I think we're pretty fortunate that here in 2020, we're still able to enjoy some of the best RPGs ever released from the Square Enix back catalog here on Nintendo Switch. Everything is here, from Final Fantasy to Romancing Saga, Dragon Quest, and even more. As both a collector and a gamer, it makes me happy to see Square preserve these titles, both for a veteran like me and for new players tackling these adventures for the very first time. Each of them are wondrous experiences that wouldn't be quite as accessible without tracking down vintage hardware, a copy of the game, and hoping that the electronic elements, such as save batteries, are still functional. I enjoy repairing and preserving retro consoles and cartridges, love it in fact, but it's not for everybody. While I'll always personally hold a preference for playing on original hardware, there's something to be said about modern convenience. And with the Nintendo Switch, that means playing these classics wherever and however I want. In the absence of any virtual console service, which was previously provided on Nintendo Wii, Wii U, and 3DS, we've seen an influx of retro game compilations from various publishers, ensuring that not only are we still able to revisit these classics without all the aforementioned hassle, but we also get some additional museum elements, such as box scans, concept art, and marketing materials. Those little additions speak to the history of these games, and are welcome inclusions.
Back in 2017, and not long after the Nintendo Switch launched, Square Enix announced one such retro compilation. But the thing was, it was only for Japan, but it got my attention.
I've had the fortune of falling in love with Square back when they were still Squaresoft, and on the Super Nintendo Entertainment System. I just so happened across a copy of Chrono Trigger while at a local KB Toys, and that game was enough to absolutely seal my love and adoration for the JRPG. I'd played classics like Dragon Quest, then called Dragon Warrior, and Final Fantasy on the NES, and some text-based RPGs on the PC, but nothing blew me away like what Square could deliver on the SNES. One series I unfortunately never got to play back then was what we now call the Mana series. Back when I worked at Funcoland, I do recall a lot of recommendations for the Mana series, but at the time, the PlayStation was now out, and we'd been graced with the likes of Final Fantasy VII. And that changed everything, opening the JRPG genre to the wider world. Unfortunately, I never managed to get around to trying the Mana series. Now, in my late 30s, it looks like I might finally have a chance. But there was one little challenge. In Japan, the Mana series is the Seiken Densetsu series, which means the Legend of the Sacred Sword. Created by Koichi Ishii, we received the first game in the series back on the Game Boy in 1991. Localized as Final Fantasy Adventure, as it was, more or less, a kind of spin-off series to Final Fantasy. Most people gained exposure to the series through Seiken Densetsu 2, localized as Secret of Mana in 1993, which was released on the SNES. If you know anything about JRPGs on the SNES, you'll know the system was home to a sort of golden era of the genre, before Final Fantasy VII blasted it to the mainstream on the PS1. The challenge in seeing any Seiken Densetsu collection localized was the fact that there was a second game released on the Super Famicom, which never came to North America. Seiken Densetsu 3 was released in 1995, and many who played it consider it one of the finest JRPGs released on the system, up there with Final Fantasy VI, Earthbound, and Chrono Trigger. Without an English translation, it seemed unlikely we'd see this package of retro RPG goodness. Sure, without having region lock on the Switch, I could still import it, but I'm still trying to learn how to read Japanese. Imagine my absolute delight when, during Nintendo's E3 presentation in 2019, I saw that not only was a remake of Seiken Densetsu 3 coming, now in 2020, localized as Trials of Mana, but that the collection of mana was also coming. The digital version was available immediately, and there would be a limited physical release. As a collector and very much preferring physical media, I leapt at the opportunity and ensured that I scored a copy. Not only was the collection of mana coming to the West, but I'd finally have a proper English translation of a Super Famicom classic. Now, to be honest, I've never properly played any of these games, though I do happen to own Seiken Densetsu 2 and 3 for the Super Famicom, along with an empty box for Secret of Mana. I really need to track down a carton manual. And, in playing Final Fantasy Adventure for this review, I actually happened to find a copy. But this is SwitchGuide, and we're going to explore these games on the Nintendo Switch. On this episode, we'll be talking about the first entry in the series, Seiken Densetsu, otherwise known as Final Fantasy Adventure. Let's go! Final Fantasy Adventure tells us the story of the Tree of Mana, which grows with the energy of will from everything in the world, existing high in the clouds and bestowing eternal power to the one who touches it. Reading this, I immediately think of another action-adventure game, The Legend of Zelda and The Legend of the Triforce. But where the Triforce is more of a spiritual power, the Tree of Mana seems more like a natural force, like the embodiment of nature or something like that. When the game starts, it literally drops you into arena combat, which kind of caught me a little off guard. But it also allowed me to get a good grasp on how things work. I am able to move around, launch an attack with my sword, and I learned that if I let the gauge at the bottom fill up, when I do strike, it will deal more damage. I found this to be a nice change-up from just wildly swinging my sword, like in Zelda, or a strictly turn-based system, like Final Fantasy. And it's after this initial battle that I was greeted with what seemed to be a recurring theme in Final Fantasy Adventure, life and death. Willy dies in front of us, pleading that the mana is in danger and that we must find the Geminites. He perishes, and we plot our escape, taking on the same monster once again in the arena, but this time running through the gates and fleeing the castle. Unfortunately, we run into both Julius and the Dark Lord, who have learned now that the mana tree is right above them. We're discovered, and we fall. Fall to the lands below. And so we come upon the other recurring theme in this game, falling. Now, the game starts proper. Traversing the overworld is very reminiscent of Legend of Zelda, and that's not a bad thing at all, especially on a portable system like the Game Boy or the Nintendo Switch. The enemies have a lot of personality, and there are towns to discover and shops to visit. Not long after we get our bearings, we come across a girl whose escort has died from unknown wounds, and learn she is looking for Bogart, the same Geminite we are. She also possesses a pendant, which comes into play quite a bit during the course of the story. As you progress through the game, you gain access to additional weapons and weapon types, some with additional effects. Axes can chop down trees, sickles can cut grass, chains can lasso posts and pull you across like the hookshot. I personally grew fond of the Morning Star, which can also save you inventory space when you need to bash through walls. Presentation-wise, I like the graphics. Though the collection of mana has a couple different Game Boy display options, I found myself particularly enjoying the dot matrix style display that reminds me of the original Game Boy. I've got to offer yet another tip of the hat to the geniuses over at M2 for including it. This feels like authentic Game Boy, and I love that. The music was pretty satisfying as well. Sure, it's chiptunes from the original Game Boy, and they certainly do loop a lot, but I enjoyed them. The sound design was pretty good too. There's nothing more satisfying than that ker-chunk sound every time an enemy bit the dust. Navigating dungeons were a lot of fun as well. There were hidden walls to uncover, there were puzzles to solve, some easy, some ridiculous. And you'll need to manage your keys because doors like to relock if you loop around. Oh, I had to make a few trips out of a dungeon and back to a village during this playthrough to stock back up. But that gave dungeons a true exploration feel, and I like that. Boss fights were a lot of fun. I really don't have any complaints here. The music pumps up, and the bosses are pretty big sprites for the Game Boy. I always look forward to the boss fights, and I truly think that's how it should be. And there's no shortage of boss fights here in Final Fantasy Adventure. You can definitely tell this was a Final Fantasy spinoff. We have a spell that turns us into a Moogle, you can get your own chocobo to speed across the overworld, and he even waits outside of villages and dungeons like the good boy he is. Later in the game, when your chocobo's legs are injured, he even gets metal prosthetics, which allows him to run across water. You go, chocobo! There's also some excellent equipment in the late game, if you feel patient enough to grind it out. I was lucky enough to get the samurai helmet and the Aegis shield relatively easily, but the RNG gods were simply not going to be merciful when it came to the samurai armor. You see, samurai armor is one of two possible drops from the ninja enemy, near the very end of the game. You think the drop rate for the Sword of Kings in Earthbound is insane? Well, you haven't met Final Fantasy Adventure's samurai armor. You see, ninjas don't always drop chests, and when they do, you better believe it's probably going to be an elixir. Now, free elixirs are not a bad thing, but good grief, just drop the freaking armor already! There! Sweet, merciful crap! At this point, do I even need the armor? I got so much XP from grinding for it, it feels like everything here is a pushover now. I digress. Now, I don't want to spoil the story here. I strongly believe that stories in video games are precious and ought to be experienced for themselves. Unlike movies or television where you're shown or told the story, and unlike books where you're told the story but fill in a lot of the details from your own experiences, video games are truly interactive, and for that reason, the stories can take on a new level of personal meaning. Final Fantasy Adventure may not have the most complex narrative you'll ever come across. That isn't to say it's not a good story, and at the very end, I was quite a bit sad. But that's the mark of a good story and a good game. We aren't emotional simply because of the story and how it goes. We're emotional because we took part in it, and the characters were merely our own avatars in that world. In conclusion, I liked Final Fantasy Adventure, and I think the collection of mana is an excellent way to experience it. The emulation is perfect, you have multiple display options, but I would have liked to see more museum content from Square Enix on this release. Collection of Mana has the games, and they play splendidly. That's the most important part. But a collection like this ought to be a celebration of this franchise, and I would have loved to see some additional materials like box scans and marketing slicks. Heck, a manual scan would have been nice for a game this old, as it took a bit of experimentation to figure out what I needed to do and how to do it. Now, there's still Secret of Mana and Trials of Mana to check out on this compilation, and we'll definitely get back to those on a future installment of SwitchGuide. I've only ever dabbled with both of them, and I want to give each its proper attention. I don't like reviewing something without finishing it first. If you want to pick up a copy of Collection of Mana for your very own, you can do so via the link in the description. Or go digital with a Nintendo eShop. That's going to do it for this episode of Switch Guide. Thank you so much for stopping by the game room. I hope you had a great time, and please come again.